Welcome to another episode of Sailing Ruby Rose. We are on board Hull 1 today. There is a lot to show you, This guy here is just installing one of the helm stations. They are being bonded in. Super damn sexy. Not the guy, the angles of that helm station, the color of that helm station. It is all a nod to the aesthetic that Miryong, and I really do need to give credit to Miryong, the designer of the interior features on a lot of this boat, needs to be given credit for. She is amazing. And literally, if I had a hat, I would take it off to her. So design features I want to walk through with you today, but also other things. There is the steering mechanism that is now in. Compared to some of the tie rods in French manufacturers that I'm not going to mention, this is a beautiful, beautiful system. For those of you who remember back in 2019, I have a whole hard on for boat manufacturers that do not actually provide a backup to just simply an aesthetic. So I want to show you exactly what goes on when they install a tie rod system and a steering mechanism in a boat and it's done properly. Keep watching, this is going to be an amazing episode. So here we are, let's just go through this first. The steering pedestal, it's just being glassed in, but there are some amazing angles. It's just being finished off and it is lunchtime, but because everything is time sensitive, this guy here is just finishing off the glassing. So super important that I don't disturb him, but things that I want to show you. Firstly, just the angulation, it is so damned sexy. The angles on that pedestal are fantastic. Also, the fact that it is all done in two tones, so you've got this very, very light gray gel coat against the white gel coat. Chef's kiss off to the designer. It is beautiful. Miryong, you are a genius. The other thing is, as discussed, I want to talk you through this mechanism and let me just, I can't get myself and the mechanism in, so I'll have to just talk you through it. But there's going to be a lot done with B-roll. It's in a dark space and I really want to get the details. We have talked so much about tie rod systems. Now, for those of you that are not in the knowledge when it comes to boating, the tie rod is simply the way that both helms and both riders are tied together. And it's a huge, huge structural component that runs transversely across the boat. It has to be a very, very strong system. And I want to show you the system in the 1370, lightweight carbon fiber. Why is it so beautiful? That the fact that I can open a locker and see things that are beautiful. Carbon fiber steering system, rose joints, and a whole set of mechanisms that articulate that are exactly what I would want from any boat. And I'm not just simply championing Seawind here. If you are buying a catamaran, if you are buying any boat, please, please, please look at the steering mechanism. Make sure that you don't just have a bolt to an aluminium pipe in a component that is so structurally important to the safekeeping of the boat. Let me just run through this with you. Let's go into this locker. I want to turn the camera away. You get to see. So here we are. I know that I'm mic'd up so you can see this. Firstly, just see from my hand, the size of this. So we've got what, a two and a half inch carbon fiber rod. Let's move forward. Fully articulated steering, look at it. I'm gonna climb into a locker and I'm gonna bore you all absolutely senseless with what I like about this. And I know that it's structural components of a boat and you'll be like, oh Nick, please just stop. This is important. Now, let's just go through. I'm gonna open up a locker and you're gonna jump inside with me and I'm gonna show you all this. So here we go. Up we go. Gas strut. Look, beautiful. Gas struts. It's the little things, no? Okay, here we are in the port side engine bay. Now, I'm covered in fiberglass dust and everything is covered and protected. I'm going to show you all this. This is how a steering mechanism should be made. Custom stainless parts. Articulated rose joints. Look, look at that. Custom brackets, custom bracket. Everything down there. Flanges, reinforcing things, reinforced flanges. And then the full Lumar steering system. Beautiful, it is beautiful. It is absolutely beautiful. Another thing I do really want you to look at here. This is the rudder tube where the rudder stop goes. It is completely sealed so that if you do lose a rudder, you're not going to breach. And even if you do get a breach, you've got a watertight bulkhead. So there you go. This is what you want to see. I can't fault it. I can't. It's beautiful. It's aesthetically very, very beautiful and safe. Split pins, decent rose joints. Remember my videos from 2019, the rose joints. It's super, super important to make sure that you've got good articulated rose joints in anything that involves movement, because otherwise friction will wear it out. So yes, congratulations. Scratch the skin, you've still got a beautiful boat. Now I want to get back to these steering pedestals and show you exactly what I mean by the angles. Steering pedestals, you're gonna be like, God, Nick, really, really, why? I just want you to kind of think about design. I want you all to kind of think, well, you know what? We could do something that's boxy and square, or we could do something that actually makes your heart beat a little bit faster. I want you to just look at the angles here. This, it's beautiful. And I've seen a preview of the helm seat. It also shares the same set of beautiful angles. It is an absolutely stunning piece of kit. Stunning. Add to that the angles on this target arch, which are now in place, and you have got a whole heap of just beautifully aesthetic design features. I am more surprised than I would be. I knew it was gonna be beautiful, but today I've really seen that Miryong and the team, the design team, are really going the extra mile to make sure that every part of this is eye-catching, aesthetically beautiful, as well as functional. And then when you scratch the surface, you have something which you're like, okay, this is safe, well built, there's so much carbon fiber, and we haven't even seen the half of it from this massive bulkhead that when you swing round, you can see it's all in carbon fiber. To carbon fiber steering, carbon fiber bulkheads down below. There is so much weight saving here.
And now down below, as we look at the master cabin, we can actually see the wood facing on the bulkheads. It looks amazing. This is going to be a really warm, cozy place to live. And as I said, this is going to be our home. Also, now those rudders are in place, look with the fairing down how smooth they are. Working at a level of detail like this gives us a lot of confidence in the build of the boat. So rudders in, fairings done, absolutely amazing.
An amazing, amazing boat. And yes, I know there've been some delays, but it's just fun to watch. Guard wires are in place now. As of tomorrow, they start the electrics on this. So again, it's all gonna start moving forward super, super quickly. It is, for me, super exciting. Today, actually, I'm more pumped about this than I have been in a while, because I'm starting to see how this is all starting to come together really, really quickly. So welcome to the diary of life in Vietnam. I sit here 7:30 in the morning with my banh mi, which is standard breakfast for the Vietnamese. And I'm waiting for my cafe sua da, which, as you know, is Vietnamese coffee that I talked about in a previous episode. Come on in. And today I want to talk to you about driving in Vietnam. I've put the 360 camera on the front of the bike today. It is something that when I first came to Vietnam, I said, I'm never going to drive a motorbike here or a moped. And I went through the whole process of starting with a 50cc moped, moving up to a bigger one, getting my UK license recognized, and then finally actually getting a Vietnamese driving license when I got my work permit. And I'll explain to you why I need a Vietnamese driving license in a minute. But essentially, the rules in Vietnam seem to follow two or three basic principles. One is never look behind you. Never look to see what's coming up beside you. I do, because I value my life, but they are literally like fish in a shoal. They just move as one, and I didn't and never really and still don't understand how they don't all die. Second point you have to understand is indicating is really optional. No one indicates. Third thing is that despite the fact that they drive on the right-hand side of the road here, that doesn't mean anything. They just drive on the left and the right. And as you saw, as I was putting in for my coffee, you just take the quickest point from A to B to get to where you need to get to. Which means that if you're trying to take a left turn, you just go into the other lane of traffic to do that turn. Plus you cut each other up and everything else, and it's a whole, I don't quite know how it works. And after 8 months in this country, I still don't really know how it works. It's just a system that seems to work. The other thing here is the traffic police, and the traffic police, the Can Sat, are known locally by a very unpopular term that I'm not going to talk about, but the traffic police tend to look out for people with bare arms, because the Vietnamese never travel with bare arms, and it's indicative of essentially expats or white guys or white women riding motorbikes, and they love to stop you
And the thing that they always try and get you for is a lack of a Vietnamese driving license and insurance and the papers for the bike, because a lot of expats here drive illegally and the police turn a blind eye to it generally. They will turn up and say, okay, well, this is the rule that you've broken, and it's normally something, and you have to pay a copy money. It is literally a system where you expect to be stopped. I have been stopped already in Vietnam. I've been stopped by the police for actually driving in a lane that was not designated for bikes. But luckily I had a Vietnamese driving license, I have my Vietnamese papers for the bike, and I have insurance for the bike. And when I gave him all those three, he was able to let me off with a smaller fine, let's put it that way. So it's very challenging riding a bike here. It is also like crazy adrenaline rush. It's insane. It is insane, just the sheer volume of traffic, the sheer amount of like crazy trucks where the drivers are jacked up on meth, just driving mentally. And what I would say is that the Vietnamese government have, in many places, they separate the roads with concrete barriers, so there are dedicated bike lanes separated from the heavy traffic. But it is like an insanity. Making turns left and right in this country is something that has to be done. You know, you literally are, it's like weaving fabric together. You have to just weave between people coming in the opposite direction. But it's what I love. I'm gonna sit and have my breakfast, but I wanted to show you a little bit about Vietnamese life. So cheers, here's my cha da, which is essentially a cup of iced tea that they give you with anything you buy. And here is the rocket fuel. So listen, cheers to all you people who wanted to see a little bit of life in Vietnam. This is motorbike life in Vietnam. Have a great day, whatever you all choose to do, and I will see you all real soon. Take care, goodbye.